All right, so Israel's desperate action, the war on terror continuation. So I'll be retreading this information to segue into the other demographics outside of Latin American, Hispanic, and Mexican border fears to go over national security issues with the Arab demographics and broader Middle East targets after 1993, or was it 1996 that the Trade Center garage, parking garage was bombed. Anyways, unfortunately, slightly reductionist related to low birth rates in developed countries, worrying about global population, generally a fear from the 1950s and 80s, but population analysis is years in advance, anyways. So, world population has become the most important and alarming new demographic trend to emerge in the past few decades. While the world has experienced low fertility rates before, they have been due to great social disruptions such as war, famine, depression, or plague, but the rates always went up afterwards. Things are different now. The global downward trend in fertility is both long-term and pronounced. The numbers are alarming. There are now 63 nations with below replacement fertility. The replacement level is a total fertility rate of 2.1 per woman. Yet everywhere, TFRs are plummeting. Today, our 44 modern nations, with the exception of Albania, are below the 2.1 replacement level. America is just on that level. And consider this incredible statistic. A European TFR has fallen for 50 consecutive years. Many European nations have a TFR of 1.2, such as Italy, Greece, and Austria. Spain's level is down to 1.1. The UN estimates that Europe's population of 72,800 million people today will shrink to 632 million within 50 years. The trend in the developing world is even more staggering. In 35 years, the TFR has fallen from 6.1 to around 2.8, and it continues to spiral downwards. South Korea, for example, has a TFR of just over 1.1, while China's rate is 1.8. This is down from 6.06 for China in the late 60s. Fertility rates are falling rapidly in Arab and Muslim nations as well. For example, 40 years ago, the TFR in North Africa was 7.1 children per woman. Today, it is 3.2 and still falling. Now, Wattenberg has written on these issues before in 1980. Seven, he wrote The Birth Dearth. So why another book? What really shook up Wattenberg and spurred on this newer book was the fact that the UN made a major readjustment of its population projections in 2002. For decades prior to this date, the UN had been predicting upward population trends for the developing world over the next half century. But in March 2002, it made a major revision of thinking on the trends in the developing world. Before this time, it assumed that the TFR in the poor countries would fall to just 2.1 children per woman. It now changed that figure to 1.85, a full quarter of child per woman. That meant that world population in the future will go down, not up. It is this new demographic that has really set off the alarm bells. Wattenberg gives us plenty of statistical information, and he points out that the US is one nation that seems to be bucking the trend. American TFR has actually risen lately, mainly due to immigration, but around the rest of the world, the picture is bleak indeed. So, this article may get to it, but Wattenberg also points out, and he talks factually, but it's a euphemism for bigotry by pointing out the low numbers, but it's mostly centered on what is known as the originalist people, like original Russians or like white people, like or the original Japanese people. I'm pretty sure you're not considered Japanese if you're a foreigner. Anyways, the causes are all the usual suspects: urbanization, education, women in the workplace, contraception, abortion, etc. But the real question is, what will be the effect of this worldwide population explosions? We just do not know because it has never happened before, at least on such a large scale. How will economies fare? How will societies change? So Wattenberg actually points all this out as a reason for why it's causing the decline. But in a book called how all politics became reproductive politics, it points out that feminists fought for time management and allocation of all of these things, like making, like being able to afford your home, have kids, work reasonably, take care of grandma, and still like not go insane. But obviously, things are way more divided. Nobody has time to clean their house anymore. And so, even cleaning was something that was vaguely what feminists fought for. Now, I'm not trying to make that argument right now. Anyways, we do know that we are experiencing aging populations, but with a shrinking supply of babies and therefore taxpayers, real crises are and are well developed in simply meeting the needs of the growing elderly population. Who will pay for their pensions and medical care? These problems will be pronounced in all of the West, but especially in Europe and parts of Southern Asia. Wattenberg looks at the number of implications of the new demographic, including the geopolitical situation, concerning the issue of freedom and democracy. The trends of up until recently have looked grim. The free Western world, with the exception of America, is experiencing population decline. In the meantime, the non-democratic Muslim world was growing. Now, with population, now most populations are in decline, including the Muslim world. With shrinking populations go declining defense budgets. America is the last remaining Western country that still has the numbers to sustain a viable defensive structure in a world threatened by international terrorism. That defense capacity is welcome indeed. So, Wattenberg, to my knowledge, I've finished The Birth Earth like multiple times. I've skimmed and read fewer so much. I've never really finished it in like a chronicle order. To my knowledge, it doesn't really t point out that automation is gonna take over or anything. Like the World Economic Forum isn't mentioned in that way, that Schwab's ideology with the third of the fourth industrial revolution. Yeah, none of that is really mentioned. But yeah, I don't it's automation taking over is sort of not a demographer's it's not what they're studying, so anyways. But how things will progress in the future is an open question. For America to sustain its role as leader of the free world, it will have to keep its population levels up. Can immigration do this? As to immigration in general, he thinks this is mainly a healthy thing and disagrees with those like Patrick Buchanan, the Death of the West, who describe it in the worst case scenarios in terms. In the short term, America and world should continue to benefit immigration. The long term gets a bit unclear, however. So in The Birth Earth, it actually is, it really is a fear-mongering issue. He points out factually that immigrants are helpful, and he really hammers this home. But if you read between the lines, it's kind of obvious that there's a fear of certain demographics that he would rather not wither away. Anyways, Wattenberg also looks at the issue of illegal immigration. In total, illegal immigrants make up only 3% of the US population. He thinks that overall, the presence is not an overwhelming problem, with potential positives often outweighing the negatives. He concludes by noting that the less developed countries could, in fact, experience a demographic dividend. He notes that poor countries with falling fertility rates are growing wealthier quicker than the rich modern nations. In the meantime, the new demography is bad for most Western nations, thus the need to spread the vision of freedom and democracy around the world. Less not or anti-democratic nations win by default by simply taking over due to sheer force of numbers, which is crazy because not everybody's all in on the same page of let's go here. It's just kind of stupid. Anyways, no one really knows where these trends will take us. Much of Wattenberg's book could be called speculative, but it is important that good minds pay close attention to these changes. This book is very helpful contribution to that effort. All right. So, of course, I wanted to read a little bit from this book. So I've probably read this before a little bit, but I'm only reading certain sections of it just to get to the next point. So, is the demography destiny? The question is always with us and often surfaces with particular urgency at times of international tension. Such a view arises with particular potency during each Israel-Palestinian crisis. Israel, we are told, is under the demographic gun as well as under fire from homicidal bombers. In New York Times, In New York Times in 2002, columnist Nicholas Kristof noted that Palestinians bear twice the number of children per woman as do Israelis, therefore making the Israeli settlements in the West Bank steadily less tenable. But Kristof was a beaming optimist compared to historian Paul Kennedy, who in the 1980s wrote that Japan would soon surpass America as the world's economic powerhouse. Yeah, no. Writing for the Los Angeles Times Syndicate, Kennedy wrote that hundreds of millions of literally hundreds of millions of young Arabs and Muslims will be on the warpath as a demographic boiling over yields overpopulation, poverty, and young male frustration to carry out attacks against the West and Israel in particular, which will, quote, obliterate Israel or drive it to some desperate action. Kennedy wrote that he was incredibly gloomy. And Ben Wattenberg just says, calm down, Paul. So obviously, I'm reading this to segue to get to my main point. So whether or not demographics is destiny in terms of the West and Israel destruction of Gaza, Rafah, Iran, Lebanon, yeah, etc. So it definitely does not justify the overall destruction of these people. All right, hold on. So on average, okay, so talking about the occupied Palestinian territory, on average, the OPT women are bearing 5.6 children, a very high rate, but down from an estimated 8.0 as recently as 1970 and 7.0 as recently as 1985. The Palestinians in the occupied territory watch television and see modern life just as most of the world does now. And the Palestinians are deciding to have somewhat smaller families. Both populations have grown. The current population of Israel is 6 million, up from an estimated 1.3 million in 1950. OPT population today is 3.2 million, up from 1.1 million in 1950. Okay, this book is written in 2004, by the way. By the year 2005, by the year 2025, the population of Israel is projected at 8.6 million. There has been much talk of terror inflicted on Israel during Intifada II and a long recession caused by the violence that drew Jews out of Israel. The second Intifada began in 2000. Still, in 2002, 34,000 migrants came to Israel. That was, however, down from the 50,000-70,000 range of immigrants between 1995 and 2000. The occupied Palestinian territory is projected at 6.9 million in 2025. In short, two countries of about 6 to 8 million people, each living side by side in peace or in war, one quite modern and one hopefully modernizing. All right. So that's obviously not what we're seeing. Obviously, Israel isn't being wiped out, as it's funded by our powerful military. It's Israel resorting to what Paul Kennedy calls the desperate action after October 7th, 2023. So I'm going to cover Kyle Kulinski on this unraveling situation. It's not surprising Biden covered for Israel his demential addled actions, bringing boots on the ground back, after he took us out a couple of years ago.
Israel and Lebanon. The U.S. has officially sent even more troops to the region. When you see the total number, it is mind-boggling how many U.S. troops we have there to effectively fight on behalf of Israel. We'll also get to a big story that came out. I believe it was ProPublica. It describes how Anthony Blinken and the Biden administration outright lied to protect Israel so they can continue to flat-out starve Palestinian civilians. It does not get more loathsome than that story. A lot to say about that. Trump and Vance have been criminally charged for aggravated menacing, among other things. I'll give you the details there. Trump absolutely crumbles into a word salad failure in an interview the other day. And also, he is looking very moist. Very moist. He's got a weak...
Sorry, guys. I kind of like Kyle. I won't cover him all the time, but...
Your thing going on with his skin.
Yeah.
You see that. And then we also have the dumbest and worst and most conservative and corrupt Democrats in America. Of course, I'm talking about Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema. Although, I think they both just recently left the Democratic Party, right? At least one of them did. At least one of them became an independent. But anyway, Kamala triggered a furious meltdown and tantrum from them. And you're going to love the reason why. It's because Kamala said something that was super...
So I could never watch Kyle, like, consistently, because obviously he's... You know, he's obviously full stop Democrat, and I appreciate his honesty for that, at least.
Based. And then Alex Jones and InfoWars, all of their stuff is now going to be liquidated, and we'll get to Hillary Clinton and her vicious smears of pro-Palestine activists. So we got
took far too long for Alex Jones to be destroyed. What the hell?
All that and much more. You guys know the drill. Everybody do me a huge favor and subscribe to the channel below. Trying to get to 10 million subs, and of course that takes a while. And by the way, thank you to everybody who supports the show on Patreon. We couldn't do it without you guys. Remember, we don't take any shady billionaire money. We don't take any money from foreign. They're really knocking me with a lot of demonetization over certain issues because I'm
skipping
Patreon support if you can, or tip on YouTube. So the Associated Press says U.S. is sending more troops to the Middle East as violence rises between Israel and Hezbollah. The U.S. is sending, a small number of additional troops to the Middle East in response to a sharp spike in violence between Israel and Hezbollah forces in Lebanon that has raised the risk of a greater regional...
It's possible that they're lying, but they're omitting a lot of things with the military they're bringing. Like, I just don't see how there's as much boots on the ground, like, say, from past wars. Now, we do see a lot of, like, Korean representation and Russian representation of boots on the ground and doing the, what's it called? The boot stomp, you know, that saluting walk. Anyways, I don't think that's necessarily the representation of the military when it's all basically cybernetic. We got robots now, like not necessarily like the shit Elon Musk is showing, but anyways, you know, like drones, we don't necessarily need the boots on the ground, but I believe this is unfortunately happening.
No war, the Pentagon said Monday. Just to be clear, the framing in this first paragraph is such chicken shit because they're very passively describing it, but you want to know the reality? Of course, it's Israel that's unleashing the gates of hell on top of the head of Lebanon. What they're describing it as, oh, violence just sort of organically broke out. Who's to blame? We don't know, bro. We can't even say, bro. Like, this is what they're...
Yes, they will call, like, five Americans dying a massacre, which, you know, fair, whatever. But then it's like they'll call it a confusing situation with what's happening in Gaza. Like, it really is the national security issue that we frame how we speak about the issue, because as much as we give privilege to Israel and the overall Jewish demographic historically, I think it's, we don't want to make them mad. We don't want to make the Zionist government in Israel mad, even though not all of the Jewish demographic agree with what's going on. Like, I'm pretty sure Netanyahu is less favorable at this point.
What they're doing, it's already weaselly. Major General Pat Ryder, Pentagon press secretary, would not say how many forces would be deployed or what they would be tasked to do. The U.S. now has about 40,000 troops in the region. On Monday, the aircraft carrier USS Harry S. Truman two Navy destroyers, and a cruiser set sail from Norfolk, Virginia, headed to the 6th Fleet area in Europe on a regularly scheduled deployment. The ship's departure opens up the possibility that the U.S. could keep both the Truman and the aircraft carrier USS Abraham Lincoln, which is in the Arabian Gulf in the region, in case more violence breaks out. In other words, if Israel keeps attacking Lebanon aggressively and defensively, and Lebanon responds because they have a right to defend themselves, we want to make sure we have 40,000 U.S. troops in the region and, massive ships and aircraft carriers and destroyers so that we can fight a war on behalf of Israel. That's the reality of what they're saying. 40,000 U.S. troops in the region. Did I ask for this? No. Did you ask for this? No. Did the American people ask for this? No. Did they vote on it in Congress? No. 40,000 U.S. troops and a lot of our Navy just sitting there waiting to be the attack dog for a psychopathic, genocidal freak like Benjamin Netanyahu. This is insane.
Yep.
This is insane. All right, let me give you more. So the other day we talked about this, but now we have some official numbers that came in. Israel bombs Lebanon. Death toll rises to 492. Over 1,500 wounded. By the way, just to be clear, that is in one day. One day, they killed nearly 500 Lebanese. All right, more. Look at this, guys. This is insane, bro. So the Israel-Hezbollah conflict, over 7,000 people.
So this might not even raise much eyebrows because people already see the Middle East as like this already terrible situation. They don't realize that it's kind of orchestrated violence and that there's terrorism that I'm pretty sure Netanyahu and the Israel military and the Western pundits, they kind of like that these people are acting out. It gives them a reason to keep continuing this war on terror. There's not enough people who really want to go to war as it used to be, in my opinion. Like, I'm pretty sure, like, as the birth rate is low birth rate is happening and more people are protesting, this may mean like demographics from the military are declining and also protesting going to war, and this is creating just they're forcing anyone to do it now. Like, it doesn't really matter.
400 cross-border attacks since October 2023. The red in this chart, that's Israeli attacks against Lebanon. The blue is Hezbollah attacks from Lebanon against Israel. Look at the discrepancy. Look at the disparity here. So the original source is the Armed Conflict Location and Event Data Project. And as you can see, Israel is firing way more into Lebanon than Hezbollah is firing at Israel, right? Now, a lot of that is the disparity when it comes to the power, because, of course, Israel is backed by the world superpower, the United States. They have endless money. They have endless weapons. We keep providing it to them. But I just need you to understand this.
Yes, we give them the privilege. There is no Jewish takeover that we couldn't just uninstall. It is a religious sort of issue of usury that the Christians, if you even wanted to be conspiratorial about money and power with Jewish demographics, it's all a Christian plot anyways.
When the argument is made repeatedly, bro, Hezbollah's the one being aggressive. Hezbollah's the one that's going on the offense. If Israel stopped doing a genocide in Gaza today, the attacks from Hezbollah stop today. We already saw it with the Houthis.
So I don't think it's that black and white. I do think there's still people who will act out, and so those small acting outs will cause an escalation. And again, that's the problem. Israel escalated with excessive force, and it didn't really need to. In a place of a little over 40 coming to 50% children decimated. Generally, in the name of the youth bulge, population control, you know, desperate young men have no life, nowhere to go, but they still have pride and fear. And you've heard that theme that I talk about, hopefully, if you've seen my channel.
They had a temporary pause in fighting that they agreed to at one point. And then immediately, the Houthis stopped going after Israel, stopped seizing the ships from reaching Israel. So we know the answer. This isn't complicated. This isn't like, oh, some nuanced geopolitical strategy stuff. No, just stop doing a genocide in Gaza, and any Hezbollah response attack stopped today. Any Houthi attacks or seizing of ships stops today. But no, they keep portraying it as, oh my God.
In general, yes. But again, there's always going to be that one asshole throwing a rock while everybody else is, for the most part, just kind of pouting and trying to get over it, you know?
Hezbollah is being aggressive, and us, poor Israel, we're just defending ourselves as we launch attack after attack after attack in
Yep.
Lebanon. By the way, more, look at this. This is the deadliest day in Lebanon in decades. So the daily deaths during the 2006 Israel-Hezbollah war, you can see there wasn't a single day where there were over 100 deaths. Wasn't a single day. But here we have, apparently according to this source, this is Human Rights Watch, United Nations Human Rights Council, Lebanon's Health Ministry. I thought it was 492 dead. According to this source, it's 558 people killed in a single day. So the single deadliest day in Lebanon in decades. This is what Israel is doing. Guys, I warned you that we were going to have an October surprise where Netanyahu was going to more forthrightly and outwardly attack Hezbollah in Lebanon and/or Iran. And his goal here is drag the U.S. in, have them fight the war for us. He knows that a war of this nature would hurt the Democrats because they're in power, and it would help Trump. He wants Trump to get a second term. He's not hiding that. It's a fact of reality. And what has Biden done? Hasn't cared. Here's been his response. Oh.
Yeah, I mean, for the most part, the Democrats have always been red carpeting the wars. Like, they never really tried to stop it. Obama ramped up the drone wars. So as much as Biden is really like he was kind of on board with what Netanyahu was doing, I think he said something maybe. And Kamala Harris has tried to distance herself from Biden, I think. But as much as she's trying to just be the fusion with Tim Walz, she still sort of stacks, at least power level wise, with Biden in terms of what he was willing to do. And so it nullifies her like stances about walking side by side with unionists, you know, because Biden at one point was pretty much. He was for anti-unions when it was benefiting him and pro it when he wanted it, you know. So it's very strange.
He's a fish on the hook. He's like, I'll send 40,000 U.S. troops to fight for you. I'll
Yeah.
go to war for Israel. Well, as I pointed out, Democrats are rat fucking their own election in that case, because there could be consequences. Guys, this is not a war that the American people are going to support. When it came to Iraq and Afghanistan, you had months and months and months and years for Iraq in propaganda buildup, where Americans were ready, like, okay, yeah, we think Saddam Hussein is responsible for 9/11 and worked with Osama bin Laden, and he has weapons of mass destruction. Go get his ass. I mean, the war was had massive support early on. Everybody knows, even with the shitty job Western media does covering what's happening in Israel and Gaza and Lebanon, people want a ceasefire. They think Israel's the problem. They think Israel's the aggressor. They see all the videos of babies with limbs torn off being pulled out from underneath rubble. So they know that. So you're not going to be able to just, hey, yeah, we're going to fight a war on behalf of Israel, and then your approval rating.
So, I feel like I would almost think my stance and other people's stance who defend the Gazan genocide at, and pointing out like it's a place of 40 plus children, it almost seems hypocritical a little bit because I'm often critical of people who say think of the children and use it to just do heinous shit to like women and like take away trans rights. But okay, literally bombing a place of the population that is 40 plus percent children. That's not the same as think of the children in America. It's not even close.
Biden doesn't take a hit. Biden's will, and by extension, Kamala's probably will too, and it helps Trump. They can't help themselves. All right, so now this one pissed me off beyond imagination. So as Netanyahu is repeatedly going on the offense and killing people in Lebanon, by the way, of course, you're not going to be surprised to learn, massive numbers of civilians. Just like with Gaza, same thing. They don't care. They view just a regular Joe Schmo in Lebanon as guilty enough. In the same way, they view a Palestinian child as guilty enough. They think, hey, that's a future terrorist, so just who cares? Kill him, right? They're openly discussing total annihilation of the Palestinian people in Israel. Okay, so Netanyahu comes out, and he delivers this message for the people of Lebanon, supposedly the people of Lebanon. Listen to what he says.
I have a message for the people of Lebanon.
Oh, I remember this.
Israel's war is not with you. It's with Hezbollah. For too long, Hezbollah has been using you as human shields. It placed rockets in your living rooms and missiles in your garage. Those rockets and missiles are aimed directly at our cities, directly at our citizens. To defend our people against Hezbollah strikes, we must take out those weapons. Now, starting this morning, the IDF has warned you to get out of harm's way. I urge you, take this warning seriously. Don't let Hezbollah endanger your lives and the lives of your
So, in the time span that he expects all of this, there's no way to actually fully plan, take your pets, take your belongings, take everything you know and love, and just move somewhere. At that point, like, you're just expected just to move and have your home and everything in the surrounding be bombed indiscriminately. And, you know, even if there was nobody harmed in that act and they waited, but you still couldn't get your stuff, that's still a genocide. Being totally relocated in that sense on a mass scale, it just is. Like, even if no bodies were destroyed.
Of your loved ones. Don't let Hezbollah endanger Lebanon. Please, get out of harm's way now. Once our operation is finished, you can come back safely to your homes.
Where have I heard that before? Oh, that's right. This is exactly what happened in Gaza.
Guys, we're creating a safe zone, and you can go to the safe zone, and you'll eventually be able to go back.
Yep, and he said that like three times. Go north, go west, go south. You know, it was crazy.
Oops! Did I bomb your entire block, your entire neighborhood? Are 70% of the buildings in Gaza now totally destroyed because we absolutely obliterated them? Did I mess up? We've heard this before. Guys, over 90% of the population of Gaza is now permanently displaced. There's 2.3 million people in Gaza, or at least there were, before many of them were massacred. And this is all the same shit.
Our war is not with you. Our war is with Hamas. And then, oh, would you look at that? 90% of the people we killed are innocent civilians in Gaza. Our war is not with you. Our war is with Hezbollah. Please.
And I love how they frame this as if it's like, guys, look how humanitarian they're being. They're giving them 48 hours to leave their homes and their lives behind.
Yes, they perpetuate the cycle of, like, the revenge of the religious cycle of pride and fear. They orchestrate these behaviors. They expect them to become radicalized. And so they have a reason to blow them up. And in this case, unfortunately, using it as an excuse to destroy just average citizens and not actually killing terrorists at all.
Fine, bro. And just to be clear, will they eventually bomb the so-called safe zones in
Yes.
Lebanon? You bet your ass. You bet your ass they will. But guys, understand this message right here. Why is it in English? It's in English because this message is not for the people of Lebanon. This message is for U.S. politicians and the U.S. public. And it's to put the window dressing over what they're actually doing, right? Guys, externally, when they're talking to the rest,
oh, yes, international law,
Arab Americans are going to hear this, definitely.
Very careful. We're dropping pamphlets. We're making phone calls. We're making sure we're very targeted in how we go after Hamas.
This is what they say to the West, but then internally, they're like, okay, so we have these concentration camps. Should we just kill everybody and get it over with quickly? How about that? Or should we continue to torture them for extended periods of time? Is it okay to torture these people? Let's have a debate about that. Oh, look, the side that says we should be able to torture our prisoners is
winning by a massive number, even though, of course, most of the people we captured are totally innocent civilians. Oops, tee-hee! Did we grape somebody to death with a metal rod? Tee-hee! Internally, they say things like, let's destroy all of Gaza and resettle it. Let's annihilate all of Lebanon. This is what they say internally. This is what you see on Israeli so-called news networks, right? This is what the government officials discuss. Externally, oh, we are being very careful. You have 48 hours to get out. Our war is not with you, even though we're about to bomb your house and your grandma and your nephew. Our war is not with you. God damn. I don't know how anybody falls for this stuff, man. Look, Israel is the biggest cry bully in the world.
I mean, if you're creating a historical narrative, then it makes sense that you would speak to the algorithm with what you intend, even if you're voting on your feet in the total opposite way. Like, there's some deranged people that I guess don't believe in voting on your feet and just go with what he said. And so it's like, oh, maybe it was an accident. It's just, these people just don't think. They just don't. Yeah, I don't know how you get attacked with a metal rod in like a military sense. Like, that just sounds crazy.
They go on the offense as they attack innocent civilians, as they start so much shit, they turn around and they're like, ah, you considered fighting back? How dare you?
Yep, pretty much.
Unbelievable. All right, now, guys, at the same time, I need you to understand, this is how the sausage is actually made. This is what's happening behind the scenes in the U.S., right? But this is Biden's national security advisor. Ready? When he attended meetings at the Supreme Court or in the Situation Room, Sullivan would think to himself, quote, there must be another room somewhere down the hall where the real meeting is happening, where the real experts are, making the real decisions, he said during a commencement speech in 2013 for University of Minnesota's Humphrey School, quote, because it can't just be us, it can't just be this. You know what? Turns out that it is. This is this guy's perception of what it's like to be in power. He's like, bro, can I be honest with you? We're kind of like idiots in over our heads, and we're making decisions, but we don't even really...
This is actually hilarious. This is dark and so twisted that this dude is even admitting to this. But like, I mean, in a economic collapse, and I mean, everybody's so desperate, I guess, you know? So...
serious people that are making the decisions. Turns out that's not true.
So delusional.
These are the people who are orchestrating and arming and funding a fucking genocide in Gaza.
Yeah.
And a new broader war in the Middle East against Hezbollah and Lebanon. These are the guys. How terrifying is that? They all have imposter syndrome. They all feel like, I don't deserve to fucking be here. Who am I to make these decisions? All right, but I got one more for you. So Biden goes, gives his last address to the UN. And here's what he says about Israel and Lebanon.
October 7th, also a determined man of wider war that engulfs the entire region. Hezbollah, unprovoked, during the October 7th attack, launching rockets into Israel. Almost a year later, too many on each side of the Israeli-Lebanon border remain displaced. Full-scale war is not in anyone's interest. Even if the situation has escalated, the diplomatic solution is still possible. In fact, it remains the only path to lasting security to allow the residents of both countries to return to their homes and the border safely. That's what we're working tirelessly to achieve.
So in other words, bro, we want peace. We want peace like really bad. A full-scale war is not good for anybody, bro. Be reasonable. Why don't you want peace with us, bro? We totally want peace, bro. As Netanyahu, day in and day out, launches aggressive attacks against innocent people, both in Gaza and in Lebanon. Look. At the very least, if you're going to be genocidal maniacs, at least fucking own it. At least have the balls to say externally what Israel is saying internally on their media and to each other, right? Don't give me this bullshit tap dance, this highfalutin rhetoric about how, bro, we're trying so hard to get a ceasefire and stuff, and nobody wants a full-scale war, bro. As you continue to send money and weapons for Israel to attack whoever they want for whatever reason or non-reason they want. Said it a million times, we'll end up saying it a million more. All you have to do is cut off the money and weapons, and this stops today. Because they can't continue. They can't continue without U.S. backing. Stop the money, stop the weapons, this stops today.
So, I think that this has been, like, escalating so much. Israel has been, like, aggressing on everybody. If this escalates any further than it has, I don't think there's a point in time where stopping will solve the issue. Now, of course, you can put up your hands and be like, all right, I'm sorry, while there's like 12 people attacking you. And that might not look very bright. Like, you just instigated all these people to attack you, and now you're like, okay, I give up. Like, that kind of seems pretty crazy, but obviously, morally, like, it's the right thing to do, but is making that move where you just stop what you're doing and stop sending weapons and Israel stops what it's doing? I do agree that this should stop, but as it's being provoked at this very time, it just seems very, like, risky for Israel in a tactical sense. Now, I'm not for Israel. Like, I still think it should exist. And my stance on what Zionism should mean is that it should mean an aggressive defense of Israel, any means necessary to defend it. Now, it existing just as a form of location for people to exist, not as a religious scapegoat. Now, but that's not the way it is, obviously. I think the way I think I've heard that thinking Israel should exist at all is Zionism, which is weird because I think certain places should exist, I guess. You know, if it wasn't such a political issue to talk about it, like, in its defense embedded in history, like, I don't think that would be Zionism, just to say that it should just exist in general, you know. Anyways,
today, get in front of the world and lie. And lie. As if, like, bro, the other side's being really unreasonable, but we're trying. We're trying to get a deal, bro. Jesus Christ, man. I'm running out of ways to describe how disgusting this whole thing is. I really am. I'm running out of ways to describe it. Because I've never seen such a clear example of somebody who's being aggressive and offensive and purposely killing civilians and trying to get into deeper shit, while at the same time turning around to the world and playing the victim and pretending like they care about peace and it's the other side that's against peace. It is so gross. By the way, there's reporting that Hezbollah was begging Iran to step in on their behalf and attack Israel, knowing that Israel was about to just totally go on and try to turn Lebanon, or at least parts of Lebanon, into Gaza. And the Iranian government was like, we're not... sorry, we're not going to attack them. It's not the right time. We can't do it. We don't want to do it, right? This flies directly in the face of all the rhetoric that we're told about how the Iranian government is the one who's aggressive and on the offense, and they can't wait for a war with Israel. And Hezbollah was begging them, hey, come in, help us. We're about to get destroyed here. And Iran's
Israel
like,
needed this desperate action.
You're on your own.
It didn't want the Palestinian population to grow. And it basically just escalated outside of that whole situation.
They know that a lot of people would die, so they're almost forced to try to take the higher road here. But Israel is... they don't care. They don't care. They will go after anybody and everybody, and they're doing it right now as we speak. So, I mean, again, absolutely grotesque, absolutely repulsive. In my lifetime, I've never seen anything like this. This puts the Iraq war to shame in terms of all the purposeful targeting of innocent civilians. There is no plausible deniability anymore. They are just going after women and children, laughing about it as they do, casually bringing up annihilationist rhetoric. And Biden the whole time is playing this game. I'll keep sending them money. I'll keep sending them weapons. I'll keep pretending like we're the ones who want peace, even though we're not. Hey, y'all, do me a favor and
yep.
Like and subscribe. It helps out big time. All
right.
Algorithm. Click the bell as well for notifications when videos drop. And watch that video.
Moving on. So, they will vote against Kamala Harris. Arab Americans in Michigan desert Democrats over Gaza. So I was going to save this for my ditching Michigan theme segment, but I think this is consistent and I can still do that. That the Trump campaign would open an office in Hamtramck, a tiny city of around 28,000 people north of downtown Detroit, less than a month before the election, speaks to a particular curiosity of the 2024 presidential race. About 40% of the Hamtramck residents are of Middle Eastern or North African descent. 60% are believed to be Muslim Americans, and the city has an overall Muslim city council. Last week, as Israel was expanding its war into Lebanon and continuing its daily bombardment of Gaza, scores of locals, many immigrants from Bangladesh, Yemen, and other Arab and Muslim-majority countries, lined Joseph Campay Avenue to attend the official opening of Trump's office. "Peace in the Middle East will not happen under a Harris administration. She's too weak," said Barry Altman, a Republican Party candidate who is running for a seat in Michigan's House of Representatives next month, and who is running a new Trump campaign office on a recent afternoon. Quote, "Trump is the only hope for peace." So I don't know where they necessarily get this from, but in terms of just voting against instead of voting for who you like, this might be just the delusion that they see. All right. Altman is not alone. Last month, Amer Galib, the Democratic mayor of Hamtramck, announced his endorsement of Donald Trump after meeting the former president at a rally in Flint, Michigan, where the pair spoke for about 20 minutes. In past elections, Arab Americans were solidly Democratic voting bloc, especially in the years following 9/11 and given Trump's overly anti-Muslim rhetoric. But with Kamala Harris reportedly underwater in Michigan, now 3 points behind Trump among likely voters, having led the former president 5 points as recently as last month, according to a one recent poll. Muslim and Arab American communities across Michigan could play a role in the outcome of the presidential election. Hold on. So this is from, all right, October 14th. So just take that in mind. Things are moving very fast in this day and age, obviously. Last I heard, Kamala was actually up, I believe. So, anyways, angry with the Biden administration and by extension, Kamala Harris for its support of Israel, Arab Americans will be willing to overlook Trump's history of closeness with Israel's hard right leader. Quote, "If and when they say, when I'm president, the U.S. will once again be stronger and closer to Israel than it ever was," he said last week. "I will support Israel's right to win its war." Yet national polls show Arab Americans slightly favoring the former president. Others are increasingly vocal in support of the Green Party, Jill Stein. While Hamtramck may not sway a national election all by itself, it offers a window into how many Muslim and Arab Americans feel about their political leaders as Israel's war on Gaza enters a second year and a spread into Lebanon. Hamtramck aside, Macomb and Oakland counties north of downtown Detroit are home to an estimated 140,000 people, around 45% Michigan's entire Arab American community, which numbers more than 300,000. Previous elections show that voting in these countries historically runs very close. In 2020, Trump won 53% of the Macomb County vote, a community that is home to an estimated 63,000 to 83,000 Arab Americans. Even within Macomb County, voters are divided. Trump won Sterling Heights, a city home to large Iraqi Chaldean community, by 11%, while Biden won West Warren, a neighboring city, by 14%. Next door in Oakland County, a largely suburban community that's home to around 60,000 people who identify as Arab American, Biden won 56% of the vote 4 years ago. But over the past year, Biden and Harris have been repeatedly rebuked by Michigan's Arab and Muslim communities. Earlier this year, a number of community leaders refused to meet with Democratic campaign officials rather than Biden administration representatives to discuss the war in Gaza. Weeks later, more than 100,000 people in Michigan voted uncommitted in the Democratic primaries in a protest vote against Biden's Gaza policy. Despite initial caution optimism, Biden's replacement by Harris at the top of the ticket hasn't changed much this picture, especially as the Middle East has grown more volatile. Quote, Harris made it very clear that she wanted to continue funding the State of Israel, said Hassan Abdul Salem, the director of the Abandon Harris campaign, at a press conference in Dearborn on Wednesday to officially endorse Jill Stein for president. Harris has maintained her stance on Israel's right to defend itself and has largely ignored the conditions laid out by the uncommitted movement, which declined to endorse her, but has forcefully come out against Trump. A poll by the Arab American Institute has Harris 18 points below Biden's 2020 level of support among Arab Americans. Quote, we know that we have 40,000 voters just in Dearborn. They are highly persuadable to our cause, and we believe fundamentally that if they come out to vote, they will vote against Harris, said Abdel Salem. The former president prevented our families, our friends, our colleagues from entering the country, he continued, referring to Trump's 2017 travel ban on several Muslim-majority countries. But the vice president killed them. Trump's visit to Detroit on Thursday marks the 11th time the former president has come to the state. Harris, for her past, has campaigned here five times. 4 years ago, Hamtramck voters overwhelmingly backed Biden, with the president winning 86% of the vote. One of them was Muhammad Hashim, who immigrated to the U.S. from Bangladesh more than three decades ago and today runs a grocery store catering to South Asian community in the heart of Hamtramck. But the Democrats won't get his vote this time around. Biden messed up the country. He's really not good for the middle class. We're struggling to survive, and today we don't get any help, he says. He hopes that Trump, on the other hand, uses his business acumen to bring down the cost of the products he sells in his stores, and many of which are imported from overseas. Trump is not perfect, but we have no choice, he says. Hashim's other major concern is Gaza, where more than 42,000 people have been killed by Israeli attacks. The number one reason to not vote for Harris is that she is supporting Israel 100%, she said. So, I feel like that's not completely true, but Trump may actually pull a stunt where he does something good in the Middle Eastern region and then actually walks that back while nobody notices, because there's some publicity stunt that happens while Trump is walking back the good thing. And so that nobody is really going to call him out on it until it's possible the next election. Somebody better catch Trump doing that, not be distracted by the publicity stunt. And when a Democrat finally gets into power again, he'll be blamed or she'll be blamed for what Trump had done to basically swindle the Arab demographic. Anyways, that's just a conspiracy of mine. Anyways, Hamtramck is considered one of the most diverse cities in a country and is the first in the U.S. to have an all-Muslim city council. Still, even if Hamtramck's mayor has come out in favor of Trump, residents and other local leaders say that doesn't necessarily represent the whole community. Several Hamtramck city leaders are attempting to mobilize support for Harris. In recent weeks, dozens of prominent Muslim leaders have endorsed Harris as an Engage Action, a Muslim voter registration group. On 3 on 3rd of October, a group of established to activate Arab American supporters for Harris-Waltz ticket nationwide was announced. Quote, "We are in a moment where our community is suffering and hurting in ways that we can account. We have also seen 4 years under a Trump presidency and what that did to our community and the risk that come with that," said a spokesperson for Arab Americans for Harris-Waltz. Quote, "We're not saying that with a Harris administration there is no risk, but under a Trump administration, the risk is much higher. We believe backing Harris is a more favorable path forward for us here in the United States, in our home countries." Meanwhile, in Hamtramck, outside the new Trump campaign office, Altman, a pastor who says he was an independent until last year, invites high school students inside for a bottle of pop. He hands them Trump flyers and literature from his own campaign and tells them to share them with their parents. Oh, jeez. So basically, people are just arguing over who's going to bomb who less and who's going to destroy who less. This is kind of crazy. And, I mean, we got ourselves into this situation. I'm not going to get into that right now. And I'll see you in the next one.